I can only imagine what it will be like.
Peace of the Lord, brother and sister, peace of the Lord to all of you that are joining us today for this Bible school. We are very glad to have you with us this morning. Peace of the Lord, Sister Marcia.
Peace of the Lord, Brother Silas.
It is always a privilege and honor to bring this revelation, I mean teaching and Bible school, to all our listeners.
Yes.
So we are very glad to have you with us. And of course, always we say that and remind all our listeners that if you have any questions, please let us know. Regarding the previous lesson, we have already studied two lessons, lesson one, lesson two, and lesson three. And today we are going to talk about the modus vivendi of the born again Christians, right? So in the beginning, we start speaking about modus vivendi. You may listen modus vivendi and you see, but what does it mean?
It's
is it
Latin.
English? You know, it is a Latin word, and we bring the definition in our first lesson. So just check it and you will understand very well. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. I would like to invite Sister Marcia to lead us in prayer.
Thank you so much, my Lord,
praise
for
the
opportunity of being here ministering
your
word, Lord. I always ask you to open our minds, our heart, our understanding, as well as the understanding of the listeners, not only to listen in the rational way, but put in practice, to understand in their hearts as a born-again person. When we find new things to obey, it's a pleasure for us. It's a way of life we adopted that came from heaven. That's what I wish for all the listeners, in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Okay. In the name of Jesus. So, Sister Marcia, what is the title of our lesson today?
The modus vivendi of the born-again Christian, which means the way of life.
Exactly.
A Christian who is born again must or should have.
Exactly. So, before any situation, how he should act in the society, and in his job places, in his environment. So, how he should act. Right, we are going to see. Last time we studied it according to the scripture in the in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. Now I will also make a surprising question, again to Sister Marcia once more again. How many laws we saw that God gave to the Israel people in the Old Testament?
613, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
She has a good mind. 613.
Don't know how. It's the Holy Spirit.
Exactly. So that's why I say that I didn't. We do not talk nothing about. We didn't speak about the question. So
yeah.
I just want. So we saw exactly that, according to Bible scholars, God gave. We have in the Leviticus book and others book. Around 613 laws or commandments that God gave to Israel people. And we know that the purpose of those laws was to keep the Israel people as a nation, to having this modus vivendi. And we find also now that in the New Testament, the way of living, as we are talking about the modus vivendi, was not based in just keeping a laws and following the laws. And it is a condition of a new birth. It's condition of a new nature that the person receives, that the Christians now, he's not acting anymore just according to his flesh, according to his own desire, but to the desire of the divine nature within him.
Yes.
So we are going to see, try to follow now, the modus vivendi, the way that the Christians should live, the new born again. So now when we talk about born again, be born again, what it mean, last time also we study about, and we are just going to today also to talk a little bit more deeper on the subject. Now let us go to the first picture with Sister Valky, who is helping us today. And I want Sister Marcy, of course, to read 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12.
All things are lawful for me, but all things are not helpful. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any.
Exactly. Now, let us rotate back. So, the Apostle Paul here is giving us the new revelation, especially for now the born again Christians, the Christians now, right? He said, all things are lawful for me. He talked first of all about the law. And now we saw, of course, last time that when we talk about the law, we are talking about the Old Testament. He said, all things are lawful for me. Now, but all things are not helpful. Now, he's bringing a new vision now. It's not about lawful, but it's about what is helpful.
Or convenient.
Or convenience, exactly, that we are going to study in this lesson. That the Christians will not obey because it is a law. Now, he will obey because it is helpful, or it will bring edification for his own life.
It will bring protection for themselves.
Protection, as we saw last time, and we are going to see in this during this lesson, we are going to go a little bit more deeper for all our listeners to understand where we want to get to. Now, I want Sister Valkyria to go to the next picture and let us read the introduction of this lesson together. If you can follow us, let me just remind you why we are putting the text is because the magazine is not yet available in the English versions. That's why we are putting the text for those who does not have this the magazine to follow up, right? So I want Sister Marcia to read the first part of the introduction with us.
As we've seen, God's purpose in the dispensation of grace is not to form God's nation on earth, but a celestial nation on earth. Then the divine objective is to transform the children of men into children of God and celestial citizens. Hence, the modus vivendi of God's people is not determined by rules of interpersonal relationship anymore, or based on a legal obligation. The subject now is not legal anymore, but what matters now is to know which modus vivendi suits the biological laws, actually spiritual laws, of the new nature.
Praise God. Amen. So now we are going to see this in the first part, what is the biological law. But let me just remind you something that we also study in our previous lesson, in lesson 2, right? What is the purpose? In the Old Testament, Sister Marcia, we find that God, he raised a nation which is the Israel nations. He gave them the law. He gave them the law to protect them,
yes,
to keep them, to preserve them as a nation. So God prepared a people to serve him on earth, right? But now in the dispensation, what we are living now, with the upcoming of the Messiah, God has reconciled us through the blood of Jesus, through the cross. He came, he died, he was buried, raised again, the glorification of God. Now in the dispensation is not anymore a physical people, but now a spiritual one. That's why we are talking actually most of time of celestial nation or nations of earth, right? So we are the church, right? When we talk about the church, of course, we are not talking about the building. We are talking about the spiritual church. Those who are born again, remember that is the title of our lesson. Those who already receive Jesus Christ as a Savior and Lord now belong to the celestial, the celestial nation who will serve God, not only on earth, but especially in heaven.
It's like being an ambassador. You represent another nation in another territory.
Exactly.
But
exactly.
You are not from the territory you are.
Exactly.
You correspond to
Exactly. That is the word that Apostle Paul used, that we are the ambassador of Christ on earth. So the church is the representation of the heaven on earth. That's why when the church will be, when the rapture will happen, now there will nothing anymore to represent God on earth. And that's why we are going to talk now with we have the all kind of the abomination, the upcoming of the Antichrist, and so on and so on. Because now the church will be lifted up. I mean, we will have the rapture, and then now those who are going to stay will be unbelievers. Yeah. So the church still now is the one who represents God and ambassador, and each Christians is an ambassador of God on the earth, right? That is the point. Now, let us go. We talk about the biological law. We talk about the biological law. But what does it mean when we talk about the biological laws? Last time also, we tried to study, speaking about biological laws, and say that as a human being, we have to supply our necessity, like eating, drinking,
otherwise,
and so on.
Otherwise, we die,
right? Otherwise, there is death now. Mm-hmm. And also, we are going to see that there is a biological law for our new nature also that we have to keep, we have to protect, we have to feed, right, with spiritual food. If not, that life also will die, mm-hmm. will not have vigor, will not be strained, will not raise or increase, something like that.
Right.
So we are going to see in this lesson that first of all, let us study what is the biological law of the new creature. I want Sister Marcia and I want also Sister Valkyria to put on the screen for you, as I said, for you to follow up.
As we've already seen, the matter to be analyzed in the dispensation of grace is not legal anymore, but what is important to know is which modus vivendi suits the biological laws, spiritual laws of the new nature.
Mm-hmm.
It means the same as there are biological physical laws that are necessary to be obeyed so that our physical body may be healthy, such as eating and drinking properly, keeping from the excessive cold and heat, etc., there are also spiritual cares, laws, which our spiritual life demands that they may be obeyed so that it may have health and vigor.
Amen. Praise the Lord. So, exactly as you can see in the preceding picture, I want Sister Valkyria to put the same picture again. Yes, so when you see in that picture, you will see, for instance, this plant that to survive, he had to take his food, I mean, on the ground, you know, he received all his resources from the ground and so on, and if not, of course, it will die. That is, I mean, it is a natural law, and we do not need to explain for mm-hmm. so much about that, because everyone will agree that if you don't receive the supply, the supply food and
from
water,
the soil and
from
water.
And the soil, sun. I mean the sun, I mean for the photosynthesis, but it will not grow, and surely will die. Now the Bible also show us, and I want Sister has to return back. The Bible also show us clearly that there is a mystery that many people doesn't understand, that the Christians have two nature. When we receive Christ as a Savior and Lord, now what will happen? We receive the nature of God. We will receive the nature of God, but our physical nature is not annihilated. We say, it will not die, it will not be canceled. We will still have our physical desire and so on. We have two natures in us.
Mm-hmm.
The Christians have a physical one and have a spiritual one. It is important to underline and to put here very clearly, right, that the Christians, now what is the difference with the unbeliever and the believer? The difference is very simple. The believer has not only a physical nature, but now has a new life, a new creation, a divine nature, a divine life within him. Now, for the one who is unbelief, of course, he just have a physical one, although he may have his conscience, right, as the Apostle Paul said,
mm-hmm.
he has the conscience, but the Spirit of God is not indwelling in him, right,
mm-hmm.
indwelling in him. It's only in the new birth. That's why in the John chapter 3, in the last lesson we study about, unless you may be born again, Jesus speaking to Nicodemus, unless you will be born again, that means that born by the word, which is the water and the spirit, you can enter to the kingdom of God very clearly. So there is this, the work of the word of God, there is the work of the Holy Spirit in the life of man for that person to become a new creature. Now, in the next picture, it is an old picture that we saw in our previous lesson. As you can see in that picture, as I showed last time, 1 John chapter 3, verse 9. I want Sister Marcia also to read that for us.
I'm sorry?
1 John, it is there, 1 John chapter 3, verse 9.
Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he has been born of God.
So he has been born of God. He has received the life from God. As we see in this, in those picture which present in the last time, you see a cow. A cow naturally would eat a grass. And he will not care about, you know, giving him like a meat, for instance. He will not care about the meat. Why? Because his, the biological law, all his systems are prepared or were prepared to receive this kind of food. The same as the lion. The lion don't eat food, or don't eat meat because he want to eat meat and he like to eat meat. No, it is because his all nature systems, biological systems, were prepared only for those kind of food. Now, at the same time we see that the new Christian or the born again Christians, when he received that nature of God, it will not be something like a law for him.
Mm-hmm. It's automatic.
It is automatic.
Mm-hmm.
So he will not be tainted, desire to eat other things which is not proper to the new birth, the new nature.
To nourish the new nature.
To nourish the new nature, to feed the new nature with the spiritual food.
It's like when you are traveling, for instance, on a vacation, and then you feel empty because, it's been a long time, I don't go to the church. And you feel like your fuel is about to finish.
Yes.
Because your nature demands that, as if you were really hungry. It happens
exactly.
to me.
Exactly.
I need to go to church. I need to go to service. I need to pray. Who is saying that to me? My nature.
Exactly. The divine nature.
Who tells you to eat? Nobody
exactly.
needs to
Nobody.
Tell you. To
Nobody. It is the same as when it is cold. You see, no one will come and say, but you have to clothe yourself very well. I mean, no. We fall over and so on, putting many clothes and so on. No, it is natural. You will put it. Why? Because you want to be comfortable before the situation. So many people actually, when they do not understand, how the way of God is working, the new nature is working, the Christian's life is, they will say, you are just obeying the law. You know, you are just following the law. But Christians, you know, Christianity is not the matter of obeying the law. You know, it's not about laws, but it's about revelation, relationship through the revelation. If I don't have the revelations, I will not build a relationship with God. Now, when I receive the revelation coming, of course, for the new nature that I have received from God, yes, I will obey automatically. Now, look, obedience to God's principles or to God's modus vivendi is the consequences of the new nature of God in us.
Yes.
I mean, the new nature in us. It is not just that I want to obey. You have so many laws, you have so many laws, you have so many principles. That's exactly why Apostle Paul said, you know, almost everything are lawful for me. You know, there are many things. All things are lawful of me, but all things are not helpful. All things are not helpful. I'm not seeking to obey to the law or to the principle. Now, because of the nature that I have, I will automatically be. So, obedience is the consequences in the life of someone who has already received the nature of God in his life.
Thank God.
Now let us read also
Thank God
first.
We received that.
Let us read the 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse. No, just in the Bible. If you have your Bible, turn it in the 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 23. Let us read that verse. I will
Again,
give
yes.
you. Yeah.
All things are lawful for me, but not all things are helpful. All things are lawful for me, but not all things edify.
Now, look, the first principles in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12, Apostle Paul, he talked about the things that are helpful. And he said that, okay, not only the things that are helpful, but there are things also that can bring person to be under their power. There are two things. So he said, we have things that are lawful, the things that are helpful, and they are the things that can bring people to be under their power. Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 23, he talked exactly, again, lawful, helpful. Now, there are things that are, what is the next?
Edifying.
That will bring edifications. So, what should be the reaction of any questions before any situation, especially to take the decision, important decision of his life? The first questions that he should ask, is it helpful? The second questions, is it going to bring edification for me? So helpful and edification, two things that are very important in any moment of your life, in any decision that you have to take, even at home. You have to reach at home and say, do I have something? What is helpful in my house?
Yes.
What is helpful? What will bring edification? I want to buy this, I want to buy that, but is it will bring edification or bring, is it helpful for you, for your family? You see that the Christian's life or the modus vivendi of the newborn again, it is not about the law. But it is now, he turned his mind is that I have to seek what is helpful and what will bring edification in my family. So even at house, so in my life first, and now even in the life, it is not something that, it is more than something that will be benefit only for me. But it will be benefit for the whole family, for the whole church. You know, people will now see, you know, the light, because the Bible said that we are the light and we are the soul of the world. So now at house, look, imagine Sister Marcia, a father before taking a decision, even at home in his house. Oh, let us buy this. And he gathered his the member of his family and said, but is it helpful? No. But is it going to bring edification for you? No. What is the purpose to having a TV or TV or maybe something? Let us go to the beach. But is it helpful for you at that moment? Will it bring edification? No. I want to buy a new robe, a new dress, a new this, a new car. Is it helpful? The car can be...
It depends.
Yes, the car can be helpful. The car can be helpful. You know? But now, what will be the purpose? Edification is something that will bring spiritual edification. The Apostle Paul is not talking about... He's talking about spiritual edification. Mm-hmm. If I want to buy that car, I want to put it in the work, you know, for the service of God, you know, that will be a good purpose. But if it is just, I want to buy it, the first thing that we have to understand, why I should buy this dress, I should buy this car, I should change the car, I should change this, and so on. Is it in the comparison with the brother or the sisters? If it is the comparison, that's exactly what we call, what?
Vanity.
Vanity, pride.
Pride.
So, that is... It is not, I'm not buying because it is helpful. It's like this cell phone, Sister Marcia. You know, I have it. It is a Motorola. Okay. Or
I have
maybe
it for 5 years already.
Exactly. Now, there is a new iPhone, which is 10,000 reals. Now, Is it helpful at that moment? I already have one for cell phone.
People buy because it takes pictures better.
Yes, it will take picture better for them to post in the Facebook, to post in the Instagram, and so on, and to show their vanity.
Right.
You see? And but what is it helpful?
No.
Does it bring edification for their life?
No, just the contrary.
Exactly the contrary. So the new born again, or the born again Christians, his attitude is completely different from the world attitude, for the unbeliever attitude. Now he's not working about the law. People are just running after. We are now almost at the end of the year, and we know that we have so many advertisements and so on that showing here, okay, this is the new year, that is this, and so on, showing many things, you know. And people just look, why I have to buy this, I have to buy that. But is it helpful? Like we call Black Friday, Pastor. Yes. Pastor, they have to preach someday like about that last time, and say Black Friday, and you see it is not cheap, you know. It's not cheap compared to the old price. It's almost the same.
Almost the same.
But people are running and buying. Do you have necessity? No. No. Is it helpful at that moment? No. I already have this dress and so on, but why should I buy another one? Why should I change the car? Why should I do this? And so on and so on. So that is very important. So to understand that we are not obeying, you are not obeying just a law, right? So there are principles. The first one is obedience through convenient interests of legalisms. And Valkyria to put the next picture for us. And the first one is obedience through convenient instead of legalisms. And I want Sister Master to read for.
After understanding the necessity of upkeep the spiritual life which we receive through the new birth, the matter related to the modus vivendi enters the sphere of law, of the legalism, to the sphere of convenience and the edification of the new nature.
Exactly. Don't do this, don't do that, don't do this, don't do that. No, that's not the principle of the Christian's life. Yesterday when I was teaching, I asked for the brethren that who here actually eat stone. They say, but this guy is crazy. No one. But I asked them, why you don't eat stones?
Good example. Yeah.
That is an example. Of course, someone may say, but this guy is crazy. Of course. But it is something that just think about, why no one eats stone or eat microphone? No, but my nature doesn't accept this. How can I digest a stone? It's not possible. It's not possible. My nature can't digest it.
Also, what kills you, it's unpleasant for you.
Exactly.
So that's why people that use drugs or smoke, for instance, they must be dominated by demons. Because the nature itself doesn't accept that as something natural.
Exactly. But, you know, there are something that we call the flesh.
The flesh.
The flesh is so terrible that the flesh can bring you even for the something that will kill your body.
Mm-hmm.
The flesh is so terrible. Because you will find, of course, the flesh we know, we call actually the triumvirate. We saw that this new word that we saw last time, the flesh, the devil and the world, they are working together. So always where there is the manifestation of the flesh, the devil is not so far. So he's near, because the flesh opened the door for him to ask access. And whenever there is a small desire of the flesh, is small things there, he will multiply that desire and bound people, you know. Mm-hmm. It can be just a desire of the flesh at that moment, right? But now he will turn to be a domination when the devil will come and act. Mm-hmm. That we call dependence. People now need completely deliverance.
Yes.
About that. So that is actually the process. But at the beginning, the flesh is able to bring many people even to be bound, you know, in that way, to open the door, to open their heart. Now the devil can have, and the demons can have get access in their life and dominate completely their life.
Yes,
it is possible.
Bring to captivity.
Bring that person to captivity.
God's laws bring us to freedom.
That is exactly what I was saying here. He said, for someone who just try to see it is law, sometimes he will be carried under the power. So when other versions, in the Creole versions, in French versions, they put here as slavery.
Exactly.
The word is slavery. Mm-hmm. That I will not be slave. I will not become a slave by nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Bring to the captivity in the same word. So it is. Of course, some things that can bring people and that are bringing many people in the captivity, and they are still there, unfortunately. So the Christians will obey for convenience.
Yes.
For convenience, not because it's a law, but for convenience. That is the first one that we have to understand for those who actually criticize the Christians and so on. The first that they are obeying because of the convenience. The first one is the convenience. It is a convenience. Their nature doesn't accept that, and for the convenience of that, they accept it. Yeah. Now, but there is something also deeper. Obedience, in one sister Valkyra to put the next picture. The second one is obedience in benefit of the human being himself. It will be something that will be benefit, helpful, as we saw. Can't read, please.
The Christian modus vivendi that is revealed in the New Testament is not composed by rules of coexistence among people, but it is the visible, remarkable evidence of a spiritual work in which the Holy Spirit, cooperating with the human will impacted by him, produces a change in the human attitudes. We shall verify, as it follows, this subject with more details.
Now, let me ask you something, Sister Marcia. The questions actually that we made. When God, for instance, he said that the sacredness of, especially of the marriage, that any relation, especially sexual relation, it should be in the covenant and in the marriage. When God put in that way, who will benefit? Is it for God himself?
No.
Or is it for the human being?
For the human being. God doesn't change because of our sins, because of our holiness. He is unchangeable.
So
all the rules are to protect us.
So now when God says, no, sexual immorality, you can use the body of a woman, you can use the body of a man if you are not in the covenant of a marriage, it's not through the marriage and so on. Who is the first beneficent, or who will profit? Is it for God? God is asking for himself, or he is protecting human beings? Of course, he's protecting us. So the Christian is himself. He obey God because this principle is benefit for him. It will be profitable for himself, for his life, his own life. It's not because God is a God who is a selfless God, you know. No, it's because God loves us. And he knows that any relationship, if he's not in the marriage, he will bring suffering.
Yes.
He will bring pain. He will bring disappointment, deception, anguish, wrath, bitterness, and so on. In the life of many. And then people will curse God and say, where was God, and so on. But you neglect his principles. So when God say, no, you can't do this. Youth, you can't do this. Oh, young man, young woman. So raise up. Do not get into this kind of relationship because it's not good for you. So God is not speaking because of himself. No, he's speaking because he loves us. He loves you and he loves me. So that is the principle that we understand. It's not because of a law, but it is because the principle, the modus vivendi that God determined in the scripture will be profitable for us. Now, let us move on. And see the third part, which is the principle of obedience through the covenants applied in the Christian's life. Let us see now in more detail. And I want the first one, which is obedience because of a covenant. The first one is that it is a necessity. Let us read in practice.
The same as the biological laws determine our modus vivendi in many aspects, and we obey them because of convenience, not because of lawfulness. For example, we eat a certain number of meals because of convenience, not because there is an ethical rule that determines it. Likewise, the modus vivendi determined by God to His children should be obeyed because of convenience. More than an obligation, its obedience is a necessity if we want to keep the spiritual health and, consequently, to live with God and inherit the eternal life.
Praise the Lord. So, in practice, what is the difference between obeying because of a legal imposition and obeying because of a convenience? That's exactly what we are saying, because of a necessity. It is not a strong obligation. It's not a rule. God is not, I want to rule over you. I want to rule over you. No, I want to dominate you. No, God is not a God of dominations. No. Although He is all-powerful, He is sovereign. He can do that. Because when God decides to do things, no one can stop God. But He's not working like that.
No.
God doesn't work like that. Many times we say God is a gentleman.
Yeah, and He actually
set
us free to the free will.
Exactly.
The free will. He gave us the free will, so He respects that.
So the new born again Christians, he will obey God because he understands that it is important for his life. It is something that is good for his life. God is loving. God is giving that love for his protection.
Yes.
It's not because, so he will rejoice. He will say, how a loveful father. He gave me the commandment for me to not be astray, get astray, to not be lost in this world. Oh, Lord, how you are so lovely. So our point of view will change. Now, when someone is not Christians, he will say, but how heavy is the Lord of God? The principle, Moses Vivendi, I don't like this kind of thing.
It's like a cow trying to eat meat.
It's like a cow, exactly, trying to eating meat. So trying, you say, but how terrible are this food? I just don't know how the lion can eat this kind. And the lion will look, but this guy, can eat this kind of food, And it will be the same when we will give grass to the lion. And the cow will say, but how the lion can eat grass? I don't know if we have so a better food than grass on the earth. What is happening to this, So each one will, according to the biological law and the nature that he has, of course, he will act differently before in the situations. So we understand, the Christians understand that obeying Lord, it will be important for his life and he will be important for his family.
Yes.
So he will bring blessing in his own family. It will be not a law. No, it will be blessing. He will, the view of the Christians will be different. That is the blessing that I will receive for my life. Oh Lord, I give you thanks for this blessing.
Hallelujah.
So let's go further. The obedience because of convenience, a benefit for the person himself. Let us see also the first one, the difference between the purpose of the human and the spiritual laws.
The legal rules which determine the lawfulness or not of certain conducts are established favoring the society. We verify that God delegated to the earthly law, the administration of the human relationships, since they are submitted to the divine principles. However, contrary to the human law, that is for the society, the divine law is directed specifically to the people individually, because salvation is individual. It's clear that if all people individually were impacted by the Word of God, the human laws wouldn't be necessary, for all feelings and human attitudes that motivate the setting of the social relationships established by the human laws would be neutralized, such as selfishness, greediness, and pride.
Amen. So what we see, of course, in the society we establish the laws because we want protection, we want to make some order in the society. We want to keep also some climate where people can live without getting into the panic. I can walk on the road with my cell phone and not be afraid that someone will attack me, and so on. And men will put some principles, of course. But now when we compare men's principles through the laws, establishment of the laws, and God's principles, most of time it's different. Although sometimes men can take some principles in the scripture and try to apply it. For instance, you will not steal, right? Mm-hmm. That is the principle that we find also in the Bible. So, but there are, unfortunately, man's principles are not directed only to something that we can bring, that can bring good in the life, even to that person. For instance, we know nowadays that smoking is bad, but there is no law that prohibits smoking, for instance, right? Of course, some drugs, of course, maconha and so on, it is prohibited here in Brazil. Other countries, they are free. Although they know that he brings destruction, the government is, you know, wasting a lot of money every year to try to treat those who are under the power of smoking. You know, they have their lungs that have been destroyed by those kind of drugs and so on. But there is no law about that. You know, there is no law. Even they are these will bring destruction to their own life. You know, unfortunately. Now, it is something really interesting because God, he does not only care about the new nature that we have in us, which is the divine nature, but also to our physical body. That mm-hmm. is very important to understand. That's why in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, the Bible 3:16, that our body is the temple of the
Holy Spirit.
Of the Holy Spirit. Our body, talking about our physical body. So God is caring about our body. He's not just caring about the divine nature. I mean, the consequences that we have received, the divine nature, is that we will also protect and taking care of the physical body. Mm-hmm. Although now we are not going to obey, right, the desire of our physical body. We saw it in our previous lesson that we can break the law of our physical body. For instance, when someone wants to fast. So eating is good. It's a biological law. But sometimes I will not satisfy my desire to eat because I want to satisfy my spiritual desire.
To reach spiritual food.
Exactly. I want to eat the spiritual food. So it is possible to break that kind of law. We saw also Jesus in the Matthew chapter 4 when he was carried to the desert, to the wilderness, where he fasted 40 days and yes. 40 nights. So we saw it, many servants of God. So we now giving priority, right, to our spiritual life. That is very important. So God's principle will care about the physical nature and also the spiritual nature. But most of time, unfortunately, although the men's laws want to keep to protect the physical nature, unfortunately, they are not perfect, right? Mm-hmm. Now let us move further. The self-destruction, the consequences of disobedience to the divine laws. That is, let us go further. I want Sister Valkyrie to put the next picture and let us see that part.
Mm-hmm. Both the biological laws and the spiritual commandments of the New Testament should be obeyed, favoring the person who obeys them. When the doctor forbids a certain person to eat sugar, he does not do it benefiting others, but benefiting the patient himself, who, if he does not obey the indicated prescription, will be destroying his own physical body.
Now, I want us to read Romans chapter 8, verse 6. Romans chapter 8, verse 6. Sister Marcia will read for us. Now, yes. Romans chapter...
I found.
Yes.
For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace.
Life and peace. So the one who obey God's principle will have life and
peace.
Land and peace. Now the one who will try to obey his own nature will have what?
Death.
Death. So disobedience will bring death, destruction.
Yes.
And obedience will bring life and peace. That is the same principles. So now if the example is here, when a physician, he asks for his patients, no, do not eat sugar if the person has diabetes. The physician, or he's not asking, or the doctor is not asking something for himself. He's caring about the patient.
Right.
And if you say, I will disobey you to this, he will not care.
Bad for him.
Bad for him. It will bring destruction. Likewise, God, most of the time, he say, this will bring destruction for your life. I am seeing that you have diabetes. I have made the diagnosis.
Diabetic.
Exactly. You are going to die. If you continue eating that food, you are going to die.
And then people, by not, look how funny we are. We don't obey God's law. And then at the end, we get angry at God because, why? If God exists, why is this happening? If God exists, but you were the one that practiced.
You know.
You broke the law and now you are putting the guilt in God.
Many people doesn't want God to judge them, but they want God to judge their humanity.
Mm-hmm.
How am I see if why this happened? Because look, this guy, they have to go to jail and so on and so on if God exists. But they want God to judge, to be righteous and judge other, but they don't want the same God to judge their acts.
Mm-hmm.
And which kind of God is that? This is an idol. It's not a perfect God that we know. But a Christian, of course, here he understands that God is all right in all his path, in all his way. And he understands that the better is to obey God's principle. The better for his life is to accept the revelation and say, Lord, I will surrender my life to you. I will accept your principle. It is not painful for me. It's not heavy for me. It will bring peace and he will bring life for me. He understands that principle and he will follow and he will trust and he will serve God.
Yes.
He understands that it is important and that it is good for his own life. Praise the Lord. Now, let's go further and seeing obedience through conveniency, a consequence of the revelation of the Christian, of the scriptures. I really like this part, and let us study a little bit more deeper to this part.
How will someone obey the word as it opposes his own human nature? Mm-hmm. So...
That is the questions. How someone, Sister Marcia, can obey is something like many people can ask. But how did?
But we said before, changing the nature.
Exactly, because which nature is it? Human nature.
Mm-hmm.
As we are talking about the physical nature, it will oppose the physical nature. Now, this means that there is a power in the spiritual nature that we have to overcome our human nature. There is the power that will bring us, that will bring the human nature under the domination, under his power. God gave us the power. Now we have, as we saw in Romans chapter 8, for the inclination, I mean the carnal mind, the human nature, for those who want to accept it their own life, unfortunately, they will be dominated by that. But for those who accept the domination of the Holy Spirit, of course, they will have the strength to come over the human nature. Now, let us see the first point, which is the communication of the soul with the body, the physical world, and the spiritual world. There is something really interesting, and I want you to follow up here.
In order to understand how someone will obey the word of God, even as it is against the human nature, it's necessary to understand what's the connection among the brain, soul, and body.
Mm-hmm.
The brain is the interface between the soul and the body. The body is the interface or link between the soul and the physical world.
Exactly.
The spirit is the interface between the soul and the spiritual world. It means the soul cannot communicate by itself. To communicate with the body, it utilizes the brain. To communicate with the physical world, it utilizes the body with all its sensorial structure. To communicate with the spiritual world, it utilizes the spirit. Very well explained.
Very well explanation. And this is very clear. That's what the Bible said, that we are a soul. We are not a
living soul.
Yes, we are a living soul. We are a soul. You know, we actually said, of course, that in first Corinthians chapter. No, Second Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 23, chapter 5, verse 23, where the Bible clearly says that we have to preserve our spirit, our soul, and our body. We understand that human being, of course, he is a soul. And now that soul is the center, of course, of human being, and that soul have the communication with the spirit, and have also the communication with the body. Mm-hmm. The body have the communication with the physical world, and the spirit have the communication with the spiritual world. That is really clear. Now, of course, we have our brain, which is a part of our body. We cannot say it's outside, a part of our body. So the brain we analyze, and then help us to take the decisions, especially the physical one, according to what we see, according to what we are listening, our brain we analyze, according to what we are feeling. If there is a gas here, you will see there is something feeling very strange here. Right? There is something strange. And then your brain will say, no, danger, danger. There is something, maybe fire, and so on. And then you will take the appropriate decision, and so on. Right? You will act. But your soul will analyze. Your soul will direct. Also, in the spiritual world, our spirit also will help us to understand what is going on. Mm-hmm. When God speaks to us, He speaks to us through the spirit. Now, our soul is the one who decide whether the next decision that I will take now, it will be according to the revelation that I receive through my spirit coming from God, or the revelation that I'm receiving through my brain, right, according to what it is, the physical.
Yes.
So now, the decision is based there. Our soul is the one who takes the decision. That's why we say it is the center of will. The soul is the center of our will. Our will is inside the soul. So that's why when you see soul somewhere, it is the will of man, the center of the human being. So now, but as a Christians now, what it is the domination? What will dominate us? What will lead us? How we should take our decision? It will be, of course, according to what we receive from God, from the Spirit. From the spirit. That's why the Bible clearly say that the one who incline, that means that the one who accept, who is directed by the revelation that he receive, he will find life and peace. Now let us go the action of the word of God in us. The action of God, when we are talking about the revelation, remember we are here speaking about the word of God, the scripture. So we can receive the revelation of God, and most of time, of course, is through the Bible, through the scripture. And there is no prophecy, even when we are talking about prophecy, there is no prophecy that we will receive which is not according to the scripture. That's why the Bible says, check all the prophecy, check everything that you receive, and look whether it is correct or not. Ah, it is a prophecy. It is a prophet, a man of God. But is it according to the principle? Is it according to the Bible? Or it is the contrary of the Bible? So we have to analyze everything. So God, of course, can speak us directly according to maybe his purpose. If God want me, for instance, to go to making missions, maybe to Italy or, I don't know, to India, he can speak to my spirit. Doing missions is already God's principle. It's the commandment. Now, yes, to a specific place, God can reveal to me, mm-hmm, and say, I want you exactly to do the mission in India. And he speak to me through my spirit, and then I go. Mm-hmm. I receive through my spirit the revelation to go there and do the work and do the missions there. That is different, right? Now, let us see. And of course, this is according to the principle. That's why I say it's already according to the principle
it's
of God preaching.
It's just something more specific.
It is something more specific, more about details the about the place, right? Mm-hmm. About the place. Now, the action of the word of God. Where does the word act in the human life? Where? In which place?
A person will obey the word even as it opposes the human nature itself when it receives the revelation of the word, which exerts an action both in the soul and in the spirit. Let's read Hebrews 4 verse 12. For the word of God is living and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart.
Okay, so this is Hebrews chapter 4 verse 12. I want sister to keep the image there. So in this here, we can see that it means, what is mean? That at the same time, it provides the word of God, provide the living experience in the spirit. You know, the word produce also an action in the attribute, which is will, right, of the soul, taking it to decide for God's will or not. That's why exactly I was saying that when we talk about the soul, we are talking, of course, about the will, what we are. The center of the decisions, mm-hmm, it is in the soul. And the Bible clearly said that the word of God is living. It is something living. Because we are a living nature, you know. That's why God doesn't give us a dead thing. He gives us a living because we are a living person. You know, most of the time we just can say, okay, I am living and so on. But God gives us also something which is living. The word of God is living. Every day when you read it, you will see something new and you will find it that it is new. Now, I want us to read 1 Peter chapter. First, let us go to 1 Peter. It's not there. 1 Peter, okay, in the Bible. And 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 23. Let us read together at home. You can follow up.
23.
Yes, 1 Peter.
Having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the word of God, which lives and abides forever.
Look, what is the last word? The word of God. What is the characteristic?
Which lives and abides forever.
And abide forever. Live. The word of God is living. The word of God has life itself. Yes. You know, look, something, most of the time you can read, but we don't understand that the word of God is living. I don't know how many times you say, I want an answer to God, you know, I want to take a decision, I want an answer. You open a passage of the scripture and you read, it is exactly the answer that you were needing. It's not just by chance, no. For a Christian, it is the word is living. At that moment, when you read it, you find that is the revelation. That is exactly how I have to act.
Your understanding opens.
Opens.
Because
you know,
you are
it is
sensible.
You are sensible. And it is clear. And it is the word. And it is living. Mm-hmm. It is living. So God wants us, you know, and he's not only living today, you know. He's living yesterday, today, and forever. Right. Because as we know, the word of God is Jesus, is Christ. And he said that the word of God, his word abide for
forever.
Forever. So yesterday was the same, today is the same, the next generation will find the same things because Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow.
Thank God.
So we have a living God. We have a living word. A living God can only provide a living things. He can't provide a dead things. Praise the Lord. Now, let us go further and see another example. B, the necessity of...
Of a steady sensitization of the soul by the vivified spirit.
Yes.
In order to exemplify, we can cite an animal contained by an electrical fence connected to an electrical energy source.
Exactly. You can see in the picture in your left for those who are...
The rabbits.
Yes. So you can see exactly we put there. An electrical cord for you to follow up. Yes, just
in touching the fence, it will feel a short but painful shock. That shock causes its brain to associate with something bad in touching the metallic wire, and it programs it not to touch its body there anymore. Nevertheless, in touching the wire again without renewing this shock, for it's not turned on, without contact with the electrical source, we'll stop being aware of that limit. Therefore, the fence has to be permanently connected to the electricity to renew the purpose of that animal in keeping its decision of being far from that spot.
Yes, yeah, similarly, of course.
Similarly, the Christian soul receives the shock through the experience generated by the Holy Spirit as he reveals himself to his spirit. This shock might be a dream, vision, an anointed message he listened to, or even a message revealed straightly to his own spirit. Notwithstanding, this same Christian will need to be connected to God as if he were the electrical energy source in our previous example, constantly, so that through this steadily revelation of the word renewed in his spirit, his soul may be repeatedly sensitized, and thereby he may renew his position of submission to the will of God, which will determine his modus vivendi as a true Christian.
Thank you very much. So what we see here, the example is clear, and as a Christian, God, you know, we have a lovely Father.
Mm-hmm.
God is not, many people doesn't have, the idea about who God is. And just think about a kind of God who judge.
A ruler.
Yes, a ruler. You know, in our previous magazine, we studied about that the will of God, the desire of God is salvation, And not only to save those who are unbelievers, but also for those who are saved, to keep them in the right way. You know, that's why even when someone want to go astray, God, it will be like this electrical source that God will say, no, not go. Don't take this decision. This will be. And how God does that? Most of time it is through visions, through messages. When someone prepared maybe to get into the red zone or crossing a red line, God said, no, maybe you just prepare something. You know, I will return back. I will do this. I'll do that. And then when you reach that, you receive a prophecy, a prophetic message that those who are preparing to do this, don't do it because it will bring destruction for your life, you know.
It's like educating children.
Exactly.
You have to say no all the time.
You know, exactly. And God know that we are weak and we have our nature, you know. That's why most of time we have to renew our mind through the scripture. By reading the scripture, only by reading the scripture, we will have communion with God.
Yes.
Reading, studying the scripture, memorizing the scripture, praying, fasting, these will build our communion with God. You know, God, he will always show us the way, and he will open our eyes and say, do not take this decision, do not go far away, do not do this, because what I have for you, it is so precious. And if you go there, you will take an alternative way. As we return back to our new magazine now, we will link everything with that. So that is the position, that is the way God wants for us, for our life. It's not that we have a terrible God, but we have a merciful God. It's so powerful, because the Bible says that God is the mercies of God have no end. You know, they are renewed every morning. They are renewed all the times. In the life of the Christians, God is always there with his arm wide open to receive us and to preserve us and to protect us in all kinds of ways. That's why we have to take heed, you know, to take heed. You know, it is very sad when you read the history books. You know, you read the Old Testament, you read the book of Ezekiel, you read the book of Jeremiah. So much time God warning the Israel people, don't go that. You know, when you read Ezekiel, you come sometime that God said, but you were naked, but I cover you, speaking to the Israel nations, you know. And I warned you, and I said to you, and I prophesied, I sent you prophets, but you didn't give heed. But you stickened your neck, and then you rebel against my commands, and you play harlotry with the nations around you. You know, God used the word there very dangerous, you know. I mean, severe, the very, very strong when you are reading that those passages. You say, but why? Because God said you were a beautiful, and made you beautiful. Because of your beauty, you play harlotry with other nations, and so on and so on. But God does not want, of course, for the believer to live this kind of way. But he wants us to always return back, and he will try, he will bring us message, he will, through the word, he will speak to us, a prophetic word, he will use the people, and so on, in the preaching, anointing message, and so on. God is God. For that is like an electric shock, you know, for that person to not, oh, you know, Evan and Cain, when the history of Cain and Abel in the book of Genesis, the Bible clearly say when Cain has the intention, just the intention to kill his brother, you know, God say, Cain, I already know what's happening, but dominate that desire. This desire is not true. Look, the sin is at your door, but dominate it. God prevent him.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, no, dominate. Don't accept this desire. I saw what is in your heart, what you intend to
iniquity.
Do. Iniquity. It was not yet sin at that mm-hmm. moment. It was iniquity. But dominate, you know. God prevent him. But unfortunately, God will always prevent us, you know, as a children of God. Now, let us go to the fourth point, which is the purpose of the modus vivendi generated by the Holy Spirit. What is the purpose? What is the purpose? The first one, primary purpose.
Primary purpose, expressing to God the relation of love with Him. Although, secondarily, the modus vivendi generated by the Holy Spirit produces in the human being attitudes that facilitate the interpersonal relationship. This one, however, is not the primary purpose of Jesus' commandments. The Master clearly said it, as he stated.
Okay, so this is the reference for those who can read. It is Matthew chapter 10, verse 34 until 37. You can read. Right, mm-hmm. You can read, but we are going to read here because we do not have the time.
Okay.
And I want Sister Marcia to read also.
The commandments.
Yes.
The commandments in the New Testament stop being law to mm-hmm. be a parameter, so that after becoming children of God, we shall know how to love our Father and how we can be similar to Him in His holiness.
Amen. So if you love me, keep my
commandments.
My commandments. So that is the primary purpose, as we said, expressing God, the relationship of love with Him.
Mm-hmm.
Obeying God is our expression of loving God, you know. And he said, if you love me, you will keep my
commandment.
Is it possible, Sister Marcia, for someone who said, I love God, but he's not obeying God's principles or God's laws?
No, you are not showing the practice of your love.
You are not showing the practice of your love. Because what show me that you do have love?
My attitudes.
Is your attitude, is your behavior, mm-hmm. how you are acting, how you are living, how
words,
you are speaking.
By words, you know, easy.
By word to say, mm-hmm. I am a Christian, you know, I'm loving God. There are many people say, I love. God, I love you. You are my daddy, you are my darling, oh dear God, and so mm-hmm. on. But his principles. Mm-hmm. And people say, oh, I love Jesus, I love you. Jesus is my husband, Jesus is my this, Jesus is my that. But Jesus will not bring nothing. And the devil does not care about that. Yeah. What he's caring is, do you obey the principle? You can say what, you can even preach. He will not care about. But when you start living, he will start caring
intimacy.
About. Intimacy with
wants.
God. So intimacy with God will be very important. Now, secondary.
Manifesting to the other man the love and glory of God. As said before, the secondary purpose of the modus vivendi generated by the Holy Spirit is the one related to the interpersonal relationships. It means the result of the action of the Spirit in man, which is perceived and felt by the other human beings. It aims to manifest to the other men the love and glory of God and lead them to Him.
Yes, let us read John chapter 17, verse 20 to 23.
I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they all may be one as you, Father, are in me, and I in you. That they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. And the glory which you gave me, I have given them, that they may be one just as we are one.
Amen.
I in them and you in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and the world may know that you sent me and have loved them as you have loved me.
Amen. By this also John
chapter. By this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another.
This, brother and sister, it is so amazing, you know. So the first, we show to God that we love Him, we obey His commandment. Secondary, we love each other, we love people around us, we love even those who hate us. And Jesus said something really interesting. By doing that, all will know. It is so important here, the word all. You know, all will know that we are Christians. All will know that we are the disciple of God. We have God's disciples. All will know when we will answer hatred. Not by hatred, but by love.
Yes.
All we know is that we are the disciple of God. You know, answering hatred by hatred, what is the difference? You know, the expectation is that if I show hatred to Sister Marcia, my expectation is her to show the same. But if she loves me back, you know, it will be something that will bring me shock. You know, Christianity is so different compared to other religions is because of love.
Mm-hmm.
What drew many people to Christ? It is because of love. You know, I do not find other religions that will say you have to love your enemy.
Yes.
Muslims say that you have, if someone, those who are unbelievers, you have to kill them. Those who are not faithful, who are not called like a faithful persons, you know, trusting the same doctrine, loving and so on. No, you not speak to them and so on. But only the Judeo-Christian point of view is the only religion that say you have to love them. You have to show them love, even those who hate them. You have to pray for them. What's something really different and the opposite in real to others' religions, you know? And Jesus said, by doing this, many, some will know. No, he said, all.
Yeah, because will know. It goes on the contrary of our earthly nature.
Exactly.
So it shows that it's a celestial nature in us. That's not normal.
It's not normal. You know, Sister Marcia, we know that this is difficult. We know that it's not something really, really easy. But it is the providing of the new nature in us.
Mm-hmm.
Romans chapter 5, verse 5 say that the love of God has been pouring out in our life. The love of God. God has poured his love in us. So now, my capacity to forgive someone and showing love. Because what brings Jesus even at the cross to say, Father, forgive them. They don't even know what they are doing. Forgive them. To those who crucified him, how it can be possible? How? So, this is, we know that it is supernatural. It's not just something that is not a matter of psychologic, you know, philosophy. No, this philosophy will not bring us to that point of view. Only the divine nature in us will bring someone, even to see someone that hurt you, someone that hates you, someone that brings bitterness in your life, someone maybe betray you like a Judah, and you see, I love you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Jesus see Judah and say, my friend. How can be? He said, but oh, my friend. And open his arm and say, in this way that you are doing to your master, my friend. Calling the one who betrayed him his friend. That is how it can be. It is impossible.
His love is embarrassing.
You know, the love of Christ, you know, we can't explain. We can't explain because there is no word to explain. Yes. The love of Christ, the love of God that he demonstrated, that he showed towards us. Now, let us drop to the conclusion and finish praying for all our listeners.
Therefore, the modus vivendi as depicted by the New Testament does not have the law's nature, but it is a consequence of the new nature of the Christian installed by the Holy Spirit, and at the same time, it is a parameter to be followed by the Christians so that this divine nature may be developed, grow, and make the old nature mortified, which pushes the Christian towards the spiritual death.
Mm-hmm.
Then the fulfillment of the rules that establish the modus vivendi of the Christian is, in the first moment, a device that displays the spiritual situation of the Christian. It means the less the Christian loves the world and the less he is dominated by his flesh, more his modus vivendi will suit the biblical pattern. In other words, if the Christian loves Jesus with all his heart, soul, strength, and understanding, and therefore not loving the world nor the worldly things, naturally he'll follow the modus vivendi established by the divine pattern. This is the reason why Jesus said that, "If you love me, keep my commandments." In the same sense, we read the passages of the scripture in John 14:21 and 15:10.
Praise the Lord. So, brother and sister, as we come to the end of this, what we understand in this lesson, the modus vivendi of the born-again Christians, we understand that it's not the principle, it's not the laws, right? If you do not retain, I don't know, listen very well, understand what was said, just read 1 Corinthians chapter 6 verse 12 and read 1 Corinthians also chapter 10 verse 23 and those passages that we just pondered, and try to check by yourself. And if you are not yet born again, our desire, of course, is for you to receive Jesus as a Savior and Lord, and get saved and starting living this one. And maybe you have been criticizing Christians in everywhere and saying that they are obeying principles, or maybe looking those who try to live according to the sound doctrine, you know, seeking holiness in their life, and say, but why they have to keep their hair like this? Why they have to dress like this and so on? Let me just tell you, it's not a law for them. It's not a matter about Lord, but it's a matter about the new nature that is in them, in their life. It is about that. So, of course, for those who are already Christians, let me just also give you some advice to come to the end of this Bible school. I would like also to say, when we have a baby, a newborn baby, the baby have life, right? The baby has life, right? But is it enough for that baby to have life? The baby have to be nourished. The baby have to be fed. The baby have to eat, you know, for the baby to grow up. If not, what will happen? The baby almost will die if we do not nourish the baby. So you have received the nature of God. You become a new creature. You become exactly as a baby. We become as a baby. And as a baby and a human being, of course, look here. We are making the comparison in the physical environment. We talk about the biological law. And then we talk also about the spiritual law. So now, if you are a newborn, I don't know which age in the spiritual level you are, but let me tell you that we are called always to grow up in God through the scripture, through the prayer, through fasting, and showing love each other, showing love in everywhere where we are, showing love, the love of God. It's only in that way that people, even without preaching the gospel, if you are just living, I mean, when I say preaching the gospel, I say preaching by opening the mouth, right? But when we talk about preaching, you can preach also by your act and your attitude. So may God bless you. As I said, if you have any questions, please let us know. We will be very happy if you can send us a message, a WhatsApp. We'll be very glad to have you. And any comment and suggestion, we will be also very happy to have your comment with us. So God bless you. Let us finish this Bible school with prayer. Lord, we bless your name and we praise you. Thank you so much, oh God, because you have led us during this time. Lord, I pray for all our listeners that you bless them, that your grace and your mercy be upon their life. I pray, Jesus, oh God, only you know their life. For those who are not yet born again, Lord, I pray in Jesus' name that the Holy Spirit bring the conviction of the sins, judgment, and justice in order for them, oh God, to open their heart and then to accept you, to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord. Lord, I pray for all our listeners, maybe those who are already born again, and maybe they are striking, they are suffering, they are fighting. Lord, I pray that you strengthen them. And we know that in the world we will pass through tribulations, but we are in good cheer because you have overcome the world. I pray to this day, O God, that you bless us, continue leading us, bless our sister here and Sister Valkyria who help us this day. To you is all the glory, the power, and the majesty. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So may the peace of the Lord be with you. Let us meet in the next Sunday with a new lesson, if God will. May God bless you, but do not left us, because we do have a program, the continuation of after the Bible school. We have either our English service or a program, English program. God bless you.
God bless.
imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side.